Hey guys, welcome back to a brand new video. This is going to be a long one, but before we get started, I just want to show you something I picked up. This is The Night Circus by Aaron Morgenstern, and it's the only book that I have that has a hole in it right there. And this one's about a circus that only happens at night. And the cool thing, I picked it up, I was kind of flipping through it, and there's a character that's male with my name. How cool is that? If that's not something cool to pick up this book, well, I don't know what is. And right here on the back is Aaron Morgenstern. I don't know if you can see that with the glare there, but I cannot wait to get to this book. So now you can sit back and watch my review of A Storm of Swords, the third book in the Song of Ice and Fire series by George R.R. Martin. Please like, comment, and subscribe, and I will see you in the next video, guys. Please enjoy this, and I will be posting new reviews on books pretty soon. I hope to have more. This video took me a long time to do, so please enjoy it. I really, really appreciate all the subscribers I've been getting lately. So thank you to all for watching, and I'll see you then. Bye. So now I would like to welcome you all to my first book review. It's going to be on the third book in the Song of Ice and Fire series by George R.R. Martin, A Storm of Swords. Sit back, relax, and enjoy, guys. Bye. So now I would like to show all the books that I've read so far in the series. I picked these up at a store just out of nowhere. I saw the covers and I knew I had to have them because I was recently into all this stuff and I just wanted to pick it up. Just, you know, I need something to read, something to get into, and so I was amazed when I read this book. It's really, really good. And a long time ago I used to read these books like in a matter of 3 months, but now it's shorter and I'm happier about that. So this one took me about 3 months to finish. So that's the first one. Here's the second one, The Clash of Kings. This one took me about 3 months to finish. And this one is more about Joffrey, and we all know what happens to Joffrey in this next book, which is A Storm of Swords. And this is probably the best book in the series. I was very, very happy when I finished this book. The ending is amazing, guys. Oh my god. I was like, how could that even be possible, you know? So now, I'm going to talk to you about every little thing that I commented on this book while reading it. So, stay tuned, guys. So starting off this video, I would like to take the opportunity to put myself back into the land of the Song of Ice and Fire series. I really, really enjoy this series more than anything that I've ever read. And I know it came out a long time ago, but this is the series for me. It's one of the best series I've ever read. I'll say that a million times because it is. So yeah, I just really, really, really cannot stress that enough. I really enjoy this series overall. The characters are so amazing. The chapters that they're broken up into, it's amazing to see. It's kind of like you're walking with them. You're right there alongside them as they're having these journeys and what they're going through. It's amazing. So as I got to page 100, I kind of felt like I was back in the world where the characters were, and I missed a lot of the characters. John was one that I really didn't care for during book one, book two, and by book three, I really felt that I actually knew who he was, because a lot of the other characters in the story had bigger plots than he did, and he wasn't doing too much because he was kind of, I don't know, like guiding himself towards the Night's Watch and kind of what they were about, because in the first book, he's barely learning to be a man of the Night's Watch. And so as the books go along, we kind of see him growing as a man of the Night's Watch until he does something that goes against them, which I'll talk about later. So going on to Arya was one of my favorite characters, like overall the book so far. She is one character that I kind of find that she has this strong ability to be herself, and she doesn't care what anybody else thinks of her. She's like that little kid kind of child, but she's really, really strong. she's had so much to deal with because she's on her own right now. So she has a lot of struggles, and overall she deals with them. She has her own friends. She is going on this long journey by herself with her friends, and then she meets up with the Hound, which in the end will take care of her, but she still doesn't really need him. He seems to just want to protect the Starks, and overall, like, the Hound doesn't really seem like a character that would actually care for anybody, because he's just like this angry, strong, big boned man, and he doesn't care for anybody, it seems. But in the end, we learn that even though he is a mean kind of angry person, he still has a heart. So I kind of like that about that chapter, that he's actually there for Arya, and later we learn that he's there for Sansa. So now we come up to a chapter about Samwell. Samwell is a new chapter in the book, and for me, I personally didn't like his chapter. It was real boring, but we're kind of learning who he is, and he's a friend to Jon, and he's always there, like, kind of by his side the whole time. And we don't learn too much about him. It's just that he's like this little puppy, kind of like a follower to Jon. Like, towards the end, like we don't see how strong he is until the end, which I thought was kind of weird. But he kind of seems like he's kind of like a poor described character. He doesn't really stick up for himself because he's too soft. That's what I personally thought, but overall, it's a new chapter. I guess I personally didn't like it, so that was my thoughts on that one. Alright, so now we come up to the chapter about Tyrion Lannister. And this one really talks about his dad, Tywin Lannister, which I cannot stand. He's always getting into everybody's business, trying to tell Tyrion who he should be with, and he's supposed to only be with Sansa, which I didn't really like when I read. I was like, really, Sansa, you can do a lot better. But this is the one that she's supposed to be with, so it was kind of weird. And everybody's forcing him to marry her, and then Tywin Lannister is also getting on Cersei's nerves and everybody else around him. It just seems like everybody that he talks to is really angry, and he makes them angry, but he just has this really grouchy kind of personality, like every time he would come up. So I was like, Tywin, you need to stay out of everybody else's business and worry about yourself. Please, you're annoying to read about, so you need to calm down, old man. So then there was a chapter about Catelyn. I've also heard her name pronounced Caitlin, but I think it's Catelyn. And that's the way the audiobook says it. I actually have been reading with the audiobook, and it makes it a lot easier to read. But in this chapter, Catelyn is giving advice to Jon's wife, which she's barely finding out that they're married. So her name is Jean, and she's kind of this kind of young girl, and Catelyn's giving advice to her about how to be a queen and how to be a wife to him. Which I thought that was Catelyn's, like, strong kind of persona kind of coming out for her. And I was really happy that she finally is back on her feet now, and she's giving advice, and she's the strong one again. And so she's really happy to give that advice, but yet she still has that strong personality. Like, and then it tells about all the things that Catelyn and Ned Stark used to be, and how they kind of came together, and how Jean should be that Catelyn to her husband, and they should be together like them. But Rob is out on battle right now, and Rob and Jean are supposed to be together as Catelyn and Ned Stark. That's the way Catelyn wants it. So she was like, my lady, I'll do whatever you want, just please let us be together. I'll do whatever he wants. And I really, really enjoyed this chapter, because they give the imagery about Ned Stark, and I was all for Ned Stark when in the first season of the show. And when I read it in the book, I was really, really going for Ned Stark, and then he died. So I was pretty sad about that, so that's my thought on that one. The next chapter is about Jamie and Brienne. Brienne gets in a battle with Jamie because I guess Jamie has this thing with her that he's like, "Woman, you're not gonna run me, I'm a man," kind of thing. And I was like, "Jamie, you need to leave her alone. You know, she's very strong, she could hurt you." But yet, he's still pushing and pushing with her. And eventually they get up and they battle each other. They throw themselves on the floor. Swords are flying everywhere, blood is everywhere, dirt goes flying everywhere, and I just really like this battle scene. And it really happened really fast in the book, and I really, really enjoyed it. So this next chapter is about Jon and how he betrays everything that he took an oath for in the Night's Watch. And he goes and meets with a wildling, and he's not supposed to be with anybody. He's not supposed to be with any woman. He's not supposed to father any kids, and he's not supposed to do anything that the Night's Watch says that he can't do. So I was like, "Jon, what are you doing?" But at the same time, I was like, he's taking on this whole new personality. He's trying to spread his wings. This is the first time we see him taking on this other worldly personality. Like, he's someone else. He's growing up. And I really like this about him. So eventually something happens to the both of them, and I really don't want to say it until later, so stay tuned. So then we come to the chapter about Daenerys. Daenerys is one of those strong woman characters in the show and book, and I really grew to like her. Her brother wasn't too much of a person, like I would say, because he was just like one of these manipulative kind of people. I didn't like him, and I just wanted him to go away. And thank God he did. Spoiler. And she meets all these people, and they're thinking that they should be with her to protect her, and this person is going to protect her, and this person is going to protect her, but yet they're all liars. And that's when she meets up with Jorah Mormont, and he's the one that she could trust right now, and he ends up betraying her. And he goes with these people, and he's been telling them about what Daenerys has been doing and where she's going. She finds out about this and turns on him and says, "Get out of my face, you know. I don't even know why I even trusted you. You're nothing to me now. You know, why did you do this?" It turns out he did it for love. He did it so he can go home, and he did it for the money. So I was like, "You can't trust him, Daenerys. Just let him go." And so she ends up getting this stuff from these other people that she comes in contact with. So she trades all that they're giving her for one dragon, because this guy said that he would trade her for the dragon because that's all she had. And I was like, "Daenerys, how can you give up your own dragon? That's like your kid right there." And it turns out that the dragon actually comes back to her, so I was pretty happy about that. So now we're back to the Tyrion chapter, and actually I think it's Sansa, and they both come together, and this is kind of where they kind of come together for real, and I didn't like it. I was like, really? But it turns out in the end, Tyrion gets ahead that he can't do this. He knows who he is, he knows how young Sansa is, and he's like, "I can't do this. This is not right." And I really like that of Tyrion, that he made that choice that he cannot do this because of how young she is and how old he is. So in the book, they did wed, but they're supposed to have a bedding, as they're calling it. I was like, "Oh no, I don't want to watch this. I don't want to even read it." So Tyrion in the end, of course, says, "I can't do this. This is not right. I don't care what they say about us. You're not gonna come into bed with me." And that's kind of what happens. So I really respect Tyrion on this little point right here. So here's an interesting little chapter right here about Jon. John goes up with a bunch of people and the wildlings, and he's with the girl that he met, Ygritte. And they're going up the wall for this horn that is supposed to be protected, and if he doesn't get it, the wall will come down and the wall will hurt lots of people because it's just made of ice and wood and all the stuff that they used to build the wall. And so I was like, John, you could have been killed going up to the wall with all those men and the ice breaking free and others falling from the wall, all to find the Horn of Joram to bring the wall down. That was close. Ygritte, you managed to save. That was so nuts. I was like, I hope John doesn't get killed because if he does, I'm gonna be so mad. I was growing to like him, so he ends up saving her and the rest of them die. So I was like, I was reading it, I was like, oh my God, please don't die, please don't die. It was really fast paced, and I really like how the guy in the audiobook reads it, so really, really good chapter. So now we come to the chapter about Jaime and Brienne, and I think the castle that they come to is King's Landing, and that's where they get taken care of. They get their wounds looked at and they get redressed and they both get a bath. And so Jaime is there, Brienne is there, and finally, like, we see that Jaime does have a heart. And coming up in the second part of it, you'll see how everything ties together and how they both actually kind of like each other at the same time. But it's funny because Jaime really likes her, but he doesn't want to tell her. So I'll tell you about that. So now we come up to the second chapter of Samwell. I really didn't care for it. Nothing happened. And I was like reading it, reading it, reading it. I was like, come on, just end already. I think it was 8 pages long. So there wasn't too much to say about that one. It was just Samwell there with a bunch of people. Nothing was really happening, so I'll just skip to the next chapter. So now we come up to another chapter about Arya, and I was like, wow, what a great battle scene in Arya's chapter. The Hound and Lord Beric Dondarrion went at it, and Arya hoping that the Hound would die. It's funny because Arya grows to like the Hound, and the whole time she's like, I hope the Hound's gonna die, I hope he'll die, I hope Lord Beric will kill him. And it turns out they're battling, they're battling, they're battling. Nothing ever really happens until the end. And the Hound ends up killing Lord Beric. And I really, really like this chapter. I could see it in my head. And you could see Arya kind of pushing for the Hound's death. And it was really, really exciting. But I wanted Lord Beric to win. In the end, he didn't win. So I don't know. I was like, come on, Hound, please just go away. I don't like you no more. So yeah, it was a really fun chapter. So now we come up to the next chapter of Catelyn. And Catelyn seems to be one of my favorite characters because I don't have Ned Stark anymore, but she's always been one of those ones that I do like. So I was like, oh, it's getting good. Catelyn is barely finding out what's happening in Winterfell. And now Robb is upset too as he learns what has happened. And they both know what happened to Sansa. But Arya, they think is lost, and Bran and Rickon, they think are dead. So what happens next, I can't wait to see. This one had me on the edge because I was like, who's dead? Who's not? Who's gonna live? Are they gonna find out, you know? And we do learn towards the end that some characters are still alive, and we're still reading about those characters. So Robb ends up going on a battle, and we see that in the next coming chapters. So Davos is one of the next characters in the story that I really don't care for. He's just boring. He puts himself down, and I was just like, when is this gonna end? I don't like him. And what happened to him? I was like, seriously? I was like, Davos, really a Lord of Brainwood? Admiral of the Narrow Sea and Hand of the King? Why would anybody give you those names, really? So he ends up getting those names attached to him, and I was like, he's not even worthy to be called that. He's real putting himself down. He doesn't even look like a king. He doesn't sound like a king. A king would never put himself down. He would always be higher up in the ranks of his people and himself. So I personally, I don't like his chapters. He's just boring to me, so. So now we come up to the chapter about Jamie and Brienne again. This is where it continues. I was like, oh, that must have hurt when Jamie hit his arm. Without a hand on the rim of the tub, and now Brienne is the only one to help him. So funny to watch in my head as I read it. This chapter, I was like, oh wow. He didn't have a hand, and he had pain that was throbbing throughout his whole arm, still from the battle. That's when he came in contact with the Targaryens in the first place. I had forgotten about that. So what they did is they end up chopping off his arm. So when he gets to King's Landing, he smacks it on the tub when he's trying to get a bath, and he's screaming in agony, and I think he faints too. Kind of like, she's clean now, and she doesn't look like herself. She doesn't have all the blood, dust, and all the dirt all over her. And now we see that she's actually has no armor on, so she's naked, and then it says that she puts on a whole pink dress that doesn't even look like her. So she's kind of angry and upset about this, but she goes, hey, at least I have something to get into, you know? So I thought that chapter was pretty funny. So there's this next chapter. It's about Tyrion, and we hear about him as a baby. So I don't know who was in this chapter, but I know it's about Tyrion, and they're making fun of him, like, because they're remembering how he was, like, as a baby, and they're making fun of all that. And he goes, I don't even want to hear about this. He goes, can you just please stop talking about it? And I just thought that was a funny little part in that chapter, and that's all it talks about, so it's pretty funny. So the next chapter is about Arya, and I was like, poor Arya, it seems like she is getting closer to being back with her mother, Catelyn, but everyone who has told her that they would help her get back to what is left of her family have lied to her. Some have left, including her own father, who died a while ago. So at this point, I thought that nobody was going to help Arya, and I think a lot of people in their lives have kind of been the Arya that we see in the book and we see in the show. I was like, can't she ever get a break? Can't the Starks ever get a break? Somebody needs to help them. We need to see Winterfell come back to what it was, and hopefully it does, because I miss Winterfell and I miss all the characters that were a part of it, all the Starks. So I'm hoping everything is good, so let's see what happens. So now we come up to the chapter about Bran, and we get to see him. This is around page 460, and this one is about Hodor, and it says, finally we see Bran again and his buddies in Hodor. This is a great descriptive chapter. It was neat seeing the description of them traveling up to this abandoned tower in the dark. Hodor screams, Hodor! It was funny, even when Bran finally had enough of his Hodoring, he spoke up and yells at him. So funny, great descriptions of the lightning storm, and overall a great chapter. I really, really like this chapter because this was another one that I could see. The person reading it on the audiobook was really, really good at actually being these characters and acting like they would in the story. So I can't wait to see how they do it in the DVD or the show. So I really, really liked it overall. The lightning storm was done well. So I can't wait to see it. It's really, really good. So by page 468, we see another chapter about Jon and Ygritte. And I was like, this is a great descriptive chapter. I'm stopping in the middle just to comment. Jon and Ygritte are in the thunderstorm as Jon shows Ygritte Queen's Crown, a tower where Queen Alysanne stayed many years ago. So as it was night, a strong bolt of lightning came down, making it the only way they could see the tower, one of the most beautiful described chapters in the book. I could see it as it happened. So this one, I think, is where Bran is. So I think that Bran is in the tower as Jon is speaking. And then Ygritte mentions something about hearing something in the tower. So I think they're in the same kind of place, but Jon and Ygritte are kind of hearing them from a distance. And I really like how when the lightning comes down and Jon is showing Ygritte the tower, he goes, watch as the lightning comes down, he goes, the tower will be revealed. And when it does, you can see the yellow that's on the crown, on the tower, which was really neat. I could actually see this one, so I'm hoping to see this one in the DVD also. Great chapter, I liked it. So the next chapter is about someone else that I really didn't care for. It was kind of boring, so I kind of skipped over it. So the next chapter following that was about John and Ygritte. So this one was actually one of my favorites too. I was like, flawless, just flawless. That was such a descriptive chapter. I hope that one's in the show. I wonder what happened to John before the arrow went in his leg. So we don't find out what happens before then, because he kind of like blacked out. I was like, ouch, poor dude. At least he still had the horse with him as he opened up his eyes again. I can't get over how cool this chapter was. It was so good that I could see it also in my head. So really cool chapter. I hope John's okay. So now we come up to the chapter about Daenerys, and this is where we find out that Jorah Mormont has betrayed her. And I was like, wow, Daenerys, you tell him. We all knew that was coming sooner or later. She's a grown woman. She can make her own decisions. Jorah Mormont, you better watch out, dude. I was like, how could he betray the Mother of Dragons, really? She has had a strong army behind her, and people that she has are actually following her, and her brother didn't really care for her, and he probably would be proud of her today, but he's dead, so he won't even see this. So I'm just like, Jorah, how could you do that, really? And I just feel that she's probably one of the strongest women characters in the book, so I really enjoy reading about her. So later on in this chapter, we see that Daenerys gets respect from her people. And I was like, Daenerys, you're finally getting the respect from your people that you deserve in the ancient language now. That's cool. And you could see her face, like in the book, how happy she was, because they don't normally do that. Her people don't normally say it in their own tongue. So I thought that was pretty cool. It's like they respected her from their heart, and I thought that was really cool. So great chapter. So this next chapter is about Arya, and we learn of something that she doesn't expect, and it's this lady that appears to her while she's out somewhere in this world, and she's sitting at the campfire with a bunch of the people that she is with and some of her friends. This is where she runs into the spirit lady hinting at a wedding. She is a weird, creepy old lady, and what we finally learn of John's mother Willa is something that she doesn't understand until later on in the book. But we finally hear of the wedding, and this is the whole event of this book, and it seems to be the most popular part in the book. It's called the Red Wedding, and I will talk to you about that later, because it is really, really awesome. I could not believe what I had just read when I read it, so stay tuned.